Thank you, Anne, and to all of our readers who, as we've been trying to hit some of the highlights of the Exodus stories, or Moses is part of the Exodus story, have been sharing story time, these longer readings, to try to capture some of what's been happening. When I was in high school, we had the opportunity of hiring a new youth pastor. And we had two choices, and one choice was somebody I knew from another youth group that was instrumental to the development of my own faith, and the other choice, he was a little more trendy as far as what you'd think of as in a mid-2000s youth pastor. He had an endless supply of camouflage pants and graphic t-shirts, and was very cool, and that's who the rest of the youth group chose, to their credit, got a lot of input in who the youth pastor would be. And I knew that I was excited that they had somebody that they would like and relate to, but I was a little disappointed thinking that the depth of the lessons that we'd have wouldn't be quite as deep. But the way Mike decided to do youth group was we'd have a time where everybody would bounce off the walls for an hour or so, or half hour, however long it was. And then there was a time of worship, and he picked out a few of our musically inclined, and they would lead a few worship songs. And then he would essentially give a sermon or a Bible study, which, you know, is ambitious for a bunch of teenagers. But people stopped, and they would at least be quiet and listen-ish throughout the lesson. And even more interesting is that he decided to choose the book of Exodus, where we would start our study, which you don't necessarily think of as a place to start with a bunch of youth in your understanding of this story of faith that we have. But week after week, month after month, these stories of people in our faith tradition, at the beginning of our faith tradition, who struggled and then struggled and then struggled some more to either be faithful or to be what we might consider successful, found an echo point even in my own experience as a teenager, where I was constantly feeling like I was struggling with any number of things. And the one thing that remains constant through the book of Exodus is that no matter how hard we struggle or how far we go into what we think is failing, God is still with them and still works with these people, sometimes even in spite of them. They are still God's chosen. And even more interesting is that even though we started in the book of Exodus and he said we'd eventually get through the whole Bible, I was there with him for 2 years, junior and senior year, we were still in the book of Exodus when I left. There's that much that you can dive into. There's that much that is part and relatable to the human story and the human experience in our faith. All that to say, just the story of Moses, 4 weeks is not nearly enough to really give it all that it's due. So the next time we come through it in 4 or 5 years from now, it'll either be a longer series or we'll approach it a little bit of a different way. So a lot has happened since we left Moses last week. And God going back and with God and Moses going back and forth, standing by this burning bush, or God speaking through the burning bush. And so to recap what's happened since last week, so to speak, in our lesson, Moses finally gives in and goes, runs out of excuses, then God continues to have answers to how he will help work through Moses. Sometimes that's with the help of others that God has appointed around Moses. So in the case of Moses not being able to speak eloquently, as he says, or Moses says that he stutters too much to be a persuasive speaker, Moses is then sent off with the help of the more eloquent Aaron, and they go together to deliver God's message to the king of Egypt. But this new Pharaoh, who's the Pharaoh after Moses' grandfather has passed, is still not receptive to their message of letting the people go. There's a series of plagues that then happens that demonstrate the power of God, the God of Moses and Aaron. They do miracles in the court of the of the Pharaoh. They, if you recall, they have the staff, and the staff turns into a snake, and then back to a staff, and then there's all those plagues. Does anybody remember what the plagues are? There's blood, and there's frogs, and there's gnats, and there's flies, there's livestock gets sick, then there's these boils, that doesn't sound like fun, hail, locust, darkness, and then there's the reversal of the policy from the previous Pharaoh of the elimination of the firstborn, from which the tradition and the holiday of Passover is instituted in the faith. And Pharaoh, after a long struggle, this section of the text, and it's part of the reason we skipped over it in our what we actually read on Sunday morning portion of it, just feels like a struggle. They're back and forth and back and forth, and it just feels like it's never going to end. So Pharaoh finally gets sick of all of it, and he sends the Israelites away. And then they're on their journey. The pillars of fire and cloud lead them as they go around, signifying God's presence in this powerful way as they're making their way out of Egypt. But after a bit, Pharaoh comes to this realization, which is the reason in the first place that this Exodus story began and Moses ended up in this basket in the river in the first place, was that Pharaoh figured, we can't lose our labor force, this free and cheap labor force that we have. What are we going to do now? And so their minds change, and they take the strongest army in the world at the time and pursue the Israelites, going to get them back. And all of it leads to this scene that we're going to have demonstrated for us from the Disney classic movie, 1998 classic, The Prince of Egypt. And it just tells it a little bit better than we can verbally.
This staff you shall do my wonders.
Don't you wish you could have orchestral scores behind the big moments in your life to know what was the big things? But yeah, there's something about the visualization of all of this that's we just can't quite get to in our reading and our words as much. And so maybe that's a way to do the story of Moses next time. We'll take clips from the Prince of Egypt, see what they highlight, and then reflect. But this scene is the culmination of over 400 years of struggle for the people of Israel. Generations came and went without knowing anything but the life of slavery in Egypt. Sometimes when we take a step back to examine the whole of our lives, it makes it easier to see maybe where there was this divine hand in all of it, maybe where God guided us in one way or opened or closed a series of doors and windows to help us get where we needed to go. For the Israelites, they had to zoom out several centuries to see the big story. And it all climaxes with this moment of Moses parting the Red Sea, God staving off the strongest army in the world, and then wiping them away instantly while keeping those who were fleeing safe. And in the way that the story is told and passed down from generation to generation, it does focus or give detail on the violence of the moment. And admittedly, that makes me a little uncomfortable as I hear it. And yeah, war and strife are indeed uncomfortable and terrible. And the fate of the Egyptian soldiers is just that. But the story is told for the reason, and is passed down from generation to generation, for the reason of demonstrating God's faithfulness to the people and God's power over all of the things that we identify as powerful in our lives. There's nothing more, there's no greater show of display of power than splitting the largest sea in most of these people's experience of life. And there's nothing short of quickly eliminating the most powerful military force on the planet known to the people as well. It demonstrates the power of the God that the people follow. And the story is told to give encouragement in the circles that it's told is to give encouragement about God's faithfulness in the time that they are experiencing now. And in any number of times in history, we can feel as if the challenges of our moment and of our day are insurmountable. And the reason that and the way that the story is told throughout its history helps us to imagine and reimagine and believe that even this insurmountable thing, whatever it is that we face, is not so when God is involved. The story thus far from Genesis through Exodus has demonstrated that God hasn't been absent during these years of struggle, but has been quietly working even in the small moments as well, working on both the individual in these individual stories of characters that we receive in the smaller ones, but also in the overarching bigger story. God is at work. You will notice that we have hit this climactic moment in the story before the end of Exodus and before the end of our sermon series. And you see, we know the struggle is real, and this is a big moment in the struggle, but it's not going to be over yet for Moses and the Hebrew people. Now they begin the quest of trying to reach the promised land, which is its own long, drawn-out struggle in which the people struggle with Moses and all of the leadership and with God and the relationship therein. So as we pan out to the even bigger story of all humanity from beginning to end, or beginning to now, I suppose, the story of Moses as the first big Messiah figure, remember the wordplay on the name Moshe, the one who redeems, the one who saves, being the root word for Messiah that we apply to Jesus, as Moses being the first Messiah figure in our faith, is important and still rings in a number of ways in our own experiences of life. Helps us to be reminded, even in the midst of insurmountable or what feel like insurmountable challenges, that we should not fall into despair. And in many generations thereafter, these struggles continue and remind us that they find this that this story of Moses finds an important echo in the ultimate Messiah figure in the Christian faith and the future story of Jesus. And in the many generations thereafter, we can think of the innumerable struggles that have lasted and lasted and lasted in the human experience, in specific, within our own human experience, within our shared human experience, within specific storylines that continue on in our world today, where we feel like struggles just will not end. We learn in our broader faith that when we struggle, Jesus is alongside. We learn in our shared traditions with other faiths from the First Testament scriptures that when we struggle, God is still at work. When we fear or we miss the mark in our Christian tradition, Jesus is with us, rescues us, and God is with us, as God is with the Israelites in the midst of their seasons of earthly victory, like this moment we focus on today, and in defeat and in confusion, and in all of the above. When they're riding high and when they're laid low, God is at work. For the church today and for us as children of God today, God is still working out both the big story and our individual stories. Maybe not through scenes so dramatic as the parting of a great sea, but rest assured, dear ones, God is with us and will continue to lead us forward, one step at a time, until someday we reach a place and we look back and see the path that has been cut through this world and this life that we live. So as we share these steps of life together, I encourage you to remember and to take time to listen for God in the little things. And even without the aid of the orchestral background, when maybe God's doing a big thing as well. So let us pray. Gracious One, we pray to you today, thinking of any number of struggles that feel too great to take on by ourselves, or even as a community together, or even as a human family together, that you'll help to draw our minds to the stories of faith that go back thousands of years of your presence, and probably before then too. Of your presence when times felt impossible, when challenges seemed insurmountable. That you have not abandoned your people, and that you continue to work through means that feel miraculous, and through each and every one of us, through very ordinary means that may not seem at the moment to be transformative, but looking back at the long run, really have been. And so, God, for all of those whom you send in each of our lives, like you sent Moses, or as you sent Aaron to be with Moses, if you sent so many to be with each and every one of us, we pray that you will continue to guide and to surround us with communities that help us to stay in touch with the hope, not ignoring the challenges of our day, but understanding that through all things, you are still God. May Christ walk with us. May your Spirit guide us and give us encouragement and power as we continue to live out this faith that you have called us to. In your name we pray. Amen.